1 Corinthians 2, verses 1 to 5. When I first came to you, dear brothers and sisters, I didn't use lofty words, impressive wisdom, to tell you God's secret plan, for I decided that while I was with you, I would forget everything except Jesus Christ, the one who was crucified. I came to you in weakness, timid and trembling, and my message and my preaching were very plain. Rather than using clever and persuasive speeches, I relied on the power of the Holy Spirit. I did this so you would trust not in human wisdom, but in the power of God. And that's the kind of ministry that I do and the kind of ministry I believe in doing. All right, so we're going to turn the clock back now to the mid-1800s, to a guy called William Miller. Now, this guy went round America with this chart. And on that chart, he had very carefully worked out the time of the Lord's return. That was very nice of him. He missed it by a bull's roar, but it was on the 31st of March, 1843. And the Millerites, as they were called, all bought ascension robes, which were made out of linen, and actually climbed up the ladders and sat on the rooftops waiting for the Lord's return. It was pretty sad, but they were very fervent that this is when the Lord was going to return. Unfortunately, he did not return on the 31st of March, 1843. So William Miller did some recalculations and worked out that it was actually the 31st of March, 1844, obviously. And so they put the ladder up against the wall again, climbed onto the rooftops, and this time when the Lord did not return, they came down. If you can imagine how gutted they felt, that would perhaps be the best word I could use. Gutted, humiliated, their neighbours just mocked them and jeered at them. And I'm talking about hundreds of thousands of Millerites right across the United States. They came down and obviously shock and grief and a whole mixture of emotions would have been going on within them. And it wasn't made very much better by the local newspapers. In fact, nationwide, this was a cartoon that was going around all the newspapers. It's a picture of a Millerite being held down by a dog on the corner of the ascension robe. Now, that's pretty humiliating. Can you imagine the ridicule that they were up for? Gutted is an appropriate word. Now, there was one person there. Perhaps you've heard of Ellen G. White, Ellen G. Harmon in those days. And she said, "I believed the solemn words spoken by the servant of God." That was William Miller. So she believed that the Lord was going to return too. And by the way, she's the founder of the Seventh-day Adventist Church. And even she said in the book, Life Sketches, Parenting and Early Life, pages 186, 187, "Many, as we have seen the preceding chapter, gave up their faith." Well, no wonder. They were destroyed. They were broken. They were crushed. There are few wounds that are as deep as spiritual or religious wounds, because a person opens their heart up very, very much to the Lord and to those around them, and in doing so, the wound goes very, very deep. And it says there that many, as we have seen in the preceding chapter, gave up their faith. The grief and disappointment of Ellen G. Harmon was great indeed. Well, what has all of that little bit of history got to do with prayer ministry? And I'm glad you asked, because it has a fair bit to do with it, as you will see. Once again, those were spiritual woundings. You will come across them. And we're going to talk now about two disciples who were in an almost identical situation. And they were the two disciples who were going on the road to Emmaus. You think about it. They too were gutted. They too were depressed. They were in shock. The one that they thought was the Messiah, the one that they thought was there to rescue them from the Romans, to make Israel the great nation that the prophets had talked about, had just been crucified. Just seeing someone being crucified, being tortured to death, I actually think would be traumatic enough without the fact that this was the Messiah and the sense of helplessness, hopelessness, depression would have been very, very severe in those two disciples. And it's on the road to Emmaus that we are going to examine how Jesus, who is God, how Jesus counseled people in his resurrected power. And there are some, it is a beautiful pattern for how we too should do it. So let's go to Luke chapter 24, verses 13 to 35. Just to give you a little bit of background, as they were walking along the road, it was about 7 miles. Now, if you, in case you don't know, it's about, you walk at an average of about 3.1 miles per hour. And unless it's depending on the quality of the road, the fitness of the actual individual who's walking, and a whole lot of other factors, but approximately 3.1 miles per hour. It was 7 miles. I don't believe they'd gone far, but they'd gone far enough to actually discuss with one another a whole lot of stuff, one with the other, down low one to the other, so that when the Lord came along, I think he just got the pricey of what they had been talking about hitherto. So now let's turn to Luke chapter 24, 13 to 35. That same day, two of Jesus' followers were walking to the village of Emmaus, 7 miles out of Jerusalem. As they walked along, they were talking about everything that had happened. Now, have you ever noticed that if there's been a bereavement or if there's been a grief, that people will talk about the deceased in the same patterns over and over and over and over again? And that is right and proper, as you will see when we do the units on grief and loss. It's normal to do that. It's right and proper. It's part of the healing process. So they would have gone far enough to have downloaded to each other a whole lot of things. And let's face it, they would not have been talking about the weather, because this wound in their hearts was so big that the pain of that would made it impossible for them to talk about anything else. That was what was on their mind. Suddenly, Jesus himself came along and joined them and began walking beside them. Now, this is very important. Where do you think Jesus actually, there's the road, where do you think Jesus actually suddenly came down? It would not have been in front of them. Can you imagine what would have happened to those guys? They would have freaked out of their brain. Even when Jesus was walking on the water and the waves were tossing, the history of that is that sailors believed that if they saw a ghost walking on the water, they were in danger and would have drowned. It's like kind of the banshee in Ireland, etc. So they, when they saw this person walking on the water, they thought they were doomed, which is really another dimension to the whole story. Well, I don't believe he would have come in front of them. That would have been cruel. And I mean cruel emotionally, psychologically, and spiritually. I actually believe he came from behind and caught up with them and then started walking along with them. How's that? Now, that's very important, because with the people that we deal with and with the people, the clients that come in, we too have to very gently walk up beside them and make them as comfortable as we can in our presence. Okay? No, okay, what are you doing here? No, that doesn't work. So that gradual coming up beside them, and there are skills that we'll teach you about that can help you in that, called active listening. Now, here goes. Jesus started walking beside them, but they didn't know who he was, because God had kept them from recognizing him. Now, yes, God kept them from recognizing Jesus, but did you know that when someone's in massive depression, massive grief, who's the last person that those disciples would have been expecting to walk beside them? A, Jesus. There's no other answer. And so I believe the grief that was in their hearts actually helped to stop them from recognizing that it was Jesus. All right. God kept them from recognizing him. And he said, "You seem to be in deep discussion about something," he said. "What are you so concerned about?" Now, I want to take those words. You know, I believe that in the councils of eternity, when God was planning to create the heavens and the earth, when God was planning to create each and every one of us, he had predestined us to be conformed to the image of Christ Jesus. Christians are predestined to be conformed to the image of Christ Jesus. Non-Christians are not conformed to be, are not conformed to be in the image of Christ Jesus. Are you with me? So it's a very interesting understanding of that. So it's only those who are Christians who he has predestined. Now, in that council of eternity, when God was working all of this out, Jesus was the mouthpiece. Jesus is a spokesperson of the Godhead. God is a group. I love using that term because it says exactly what I want to say. The Godhead is a group. I used to lecture on cults, and that's the only word that cannot be misunderstood. There's a whole lot of words that can be misunderstood, but when you say God's a group of three persons that make one and only one God, it's like playing three harmonious notes on a musical instrument, producing one and only one harmonious sound. And because God's a group, Jesus becomes a spokesman. And the whole universe was created through Jesus. Because he's the mouthpiece for the Godhead, all things were created through him, and without him, nothing has been made that has been made. John chapter 1, verse 3. So he is a spokesperson. Every word that God says, can you imagine that it is meticulously accurate? Now, if I were to say, "Hey, how you going?" that would be just a bit of a throwaway line, because you'd possibly say, "Well, thanks," and you may or may not be, but it's a good level one communication to go to level two, level three, level four, and level five. So that's an important stage. But what Jesus said was not a throwaway line. It was prophetic in the extreme. Anything that God says is prophetic. It's either foretelling, which means telling the future, or forthtelling, which means proclaiming things there and then. And this was forthtelling prophecy. So anything that Jesus says is not a throwaway line. And when he said, "Hey, what are you guys talking about? Why are you so concerned?" he was targeting something very, very specifically. Now, I use the terminology targeting the hurt. And that's what the Lord was doing to these two disciples. If someone's been hit with a car, Mack truck, Bondi bus, doesn't matter, and they're on the road, and there's a kind of a fountain of blood coming out, if you really want to encourage them, there are two things you could do. One is to read them one of Shakespeare's sonnets and hope they get really inspired. Or the other is to target the hurt and plug up the hole. And by targeting the hurt, plugging up the hole, I believe that is the best way to encourage someone. So he targeted their hurt. What are you so concerned about? They stop short, sadness written across their faces. That's all it took. That one question is all it took to stop them. That's how fragile these guys were. Many of the people that come into my office are equally as fragile. They stop short, sadness written across their faces. Then one of them, Cleopas, replied, "You must be the only person in Jerusalem who hasn't heard about all the things that have happened there the last few days." "What things?" Jesus asked. And not another throwaway line. What things is actually called, it's now got terminology to it, a minimal prompt. If you do active listening, it's called a minimal prompt. And it means, tell me more, keep going, I want to hear more. I want you to empty the bottle just a little bit more than you have. "The things that happened to Jesus, the man from Nazareth," they said. "He was a prophet who did wonderful miracles. He was a mighty teacher, highly regarded by both God and all the people. But our leaders, leading priests and the other religious leaders, arrested him and handed him over to be condemned to death. And they crucified him. We had thought that he was the Messiah who had come to rescue Israel. That all happened 3 days ago. Then some women from our group of his followers were at the tomb early this morning, and they came back with an amazing report." Now, in the midst of their brokenness and guttedness, there is now a small flicker of hope. Could have been up to 5-6 women, went to the tomb with the embalming oil and so forth, because they couldn't do it on the Sabbath, and the Sabbath starts at sundown on Friday night. They couldn't do it then, so they went back on Sunday morning to do it, and he wasn't there. Then Peter and a couple of the guys came and checked, and they gave the same report that his body had been taken. And his body was missing. They had seen angels who told them that Jesus is alive. So the first part of their healing has just started to occur with those reports. "Some of our men ran out to see, and sure enough, Jesus' body was gone just as the women had said." All right. In doing that, Jesus has demonstrated the ministry of encouragement. About 23 years ago, I went to a seminar called Caring by Selwyn Hughes, and I've just spent 5 minutes on how Jesus encouraged those two guys, but they spent the whole day on it, and you actually got a stamp, and you were not allowed to come to day two, which is the next stage of the healing process, until you had done the day on encouragement. Encouragement is the expression we use, either verbally or non-verbally, in helping a person cope with or overcome a difficult time in their life. The ministry of encouragement is like being a stretcher bearer. Remember I said it's plugging up the hole by targeting the hurt and by allowing the bottle to be emptied. Sometimes the ministry of encouragement can just be sitting with someone. I used to do palliative care volunteering, and if someone has terminal cancer, just sitting there saying nothing is a ministry of presence. It can be very, very encouraging to them at that particular time. Encouragement does not mean to give someone a biblical text. How's that? If we go back 30, 40 years, the counseling book that I had in those days was a little book, and if you bereaved, well, there's a whole lot of scriptures. If you're depressed, there's a whole lot of scriptures. If you have a problem with anger, there's a whole lot of scriptures. I don't believe you should use scriptures until you have earned the right to speak into a person's life. And that is done through the ministry of encouragement. Capital E for encouragement. And as Jesus used minimal prompts and questioning, open sentences, open questions to elicit more response from the two disciples, they're all active listening, I'm going to say techniques, but they're not techniques. We've made them techniques, but they're just normal, natural things that you would do in that circumstance. Anyone with a heart would do that. But nowadays you study how to do it. Okay? All right. The client's the primary storyteller. The counselor is to be the companion on the journey. And as I put there, people don't want to know how much you know, all those scriptures, until they know how much you care. Jesus, who is Almighty God, actually earned the right to speak into their lives by coming up beside them, encouraging them. And when he had done that, then we can move on to Luke chapter 24, verse 25 to 27, which is the second stage of the healing process. Then Jesus said to them, "You are such foolish people." And that kind of means you're slow to understand. And I think if I'd just been crucified to death, I would say something like that too. "You are so thick." But he would do it in the most loving and kind way, whereas I may not. "You find it so hard to believe all that the prophets wrote in the scriptures. Wasn't it clearly predicted by the prophets that the Messiah would have to suffer these things before entering into his time of glory? That may never have occurred to them." Then Jesus quoted passages from the writing of Moses and all the prophets, explaining what all the scriptures said about him. Now, once again, every scripture that Jesus took out from the Old Testament writings about himself would have been meticulously known to minister to that wound in their life, and that wound in their life, and that wound in their life. Each scripture he used would have been an ointment or an antibiotic on the wounds that were either in that guy or that guy. They were not randomly chosen, because everything Jesus does is prophetic. He knows those two guys inside out. He knows which scriptures need to be talked about and which do not need to be talked about. And he chose the ones that would do the greatest healing in their lives. I hope that's not too hard to come to terms with. Then Jesus quoted passages from the writing of Moses and all the prophets, explaining what all the scriptures said about him. And this is stage two. This is Jesus demonstrating the ministry of exhortation. And in that ministry, exhortation means bringing the word of God and targeting the core belief systems, and we'll talk about those in a minute. These two disciples had some very interesting core belief systems, and they had to be addressed, they had to be ministered to. The scriptures that he used would have applied specifically to those core belief systems that were wrong. They thought it was all over by the shouting. They'd put all their eggs in one basket. They thought the whole lot had just smashed, and they were up the creek without a paddle, so to speak. But he would have now brought in the ministry of exhortation. Now, with the ministry of exhortation, it will bring clear direction and purpose through instruction, And the truth will be shared in a context of personal relationships. He earned that right. Okay. If you look at this little graph here, you can either have truth, the scriptures, with no relationship, or you can go to the other end of the continuum and have relationship with no truth. The letter killeth, but the spirit gives life. Well, on that end, truth but no relationship, the letter killeth. And I don't know if you've ever had anyone quote scriptures at you that have been very inappropriate to do so. And at this side, relationship with no truth can be such a sloppy, messy, emotional kind of relationship, no one's going anywhere. It needs to be somewhere in the middle there to encourage strength and to encourage growth. Now, let's go a little bit further with this stage of exhortation where God speaks into a situation. All right, we've got two guys here, Vic and Ralph. And you may think of some people in the church like this. I don't know. I haven't got anyone in mind, so I can say it very clearly. All right, Vic, he's a businessman, really well-to-do. He comes to church because that's part of his deal. That's what rich people do. That's what well-to-do is part of, you know, the job profile of being in the upper crust and all that kind of thing. However, beneath all of that glitz and glamour, there is a fear. I have to be more successful than Dad, or I'll be unhappy just like him. And that's a core belief system. So Vic, this well-to-do guy, even though things may look well on the surface, that fear down beneath is crippling him and motivating him to be something he shouldn't be. And as I said, part of his success package includes church attendance. His fears remain conveniently shielded from view. No one would know. So well hidden that not even he is aware of his purpose in living to prove a point and reduce a fear. These core belief systems are so deep within our life, some people call them life scripts, but these core belief systems are so deep they literally control our life and control what we do. If I believed a certain thing, that standing in front of people was a place where I would get judged and criticized, etc., etc., if that was my core belief system, I wouldn't be here right now. Because that core belief system would really shake my nerves, shake my belief systems, and shake my whole life. So these core belief systems, which we'll talk a lot about later, are very important. Because no one understands him, no one really encourages Vic. They think he's got it all together anyway. Because fear continues to quietly dominate his life. His layers, the self-protective styles of relating, the way he protects his life, the shields and walls that he puts up around himself. Did you know that putting up walls is actually sin? Where in the Bible does it say we have to put walls up to protect ourselves? Isn't the Lord our strong right arm? Isn't he our protector? Isn't he the tower that the righteous run into and are safe? Now, we have to guard our heart with all diligence, and I believe that, but to actually protect ourselves is not what we're supposed to do. So it's sin. And by the way, as we build the blocks and the walls around ourselves, we're not only blocking out people, we're actually blocking out God as well. You can't put those walls up without blocking out God. So therefore, vertically, you're blocking out God. Horizontally, you're blocking out people, and that's not the way it was meant to be. Learning how to draw boundaries, which we'll come to in another session, learning how to draw boundaries is the correct way of protecting your life. And that's another session. Okay, Vic is blind to his own spiritual poverty. He wouldn't even know that that fear within him is making him behave that way. He may just think it's normal to behave that way. All right, let's go now to Ralph. Ralph is different. He's visibly insecure. By the way, this is from a book called Encouragement by Larry Crabb. If you've ever heard of Larry Crabb. Now, Ralph has not been blessed with the tools of the effective layers. He doesn't know how to protect himself, and he's kind of like a hermit crab outside its shell. When Ralph shows up in the church membership class, no one's excited about it. While Vic is shaking hands and chatting sociably, Ralph takes 4 or 5 minutes to stir his sugared coffee, hoping to disguise his feelings of isolation. And he tries, motivated by persistent pressure to be what he should be. He's a nobody, and nothing will ever change that brute fact. So he turns to drinking a little bit more, just stopping occasionally at an adult bookshop. And things are not good for him. So we have Vic and Ralph. One has effective layers, the other less effective layers. And it's interesting what happens when the truth hits both of them, because they are now both without relationship. And you cannot exhort, that's stage two of what Jesus did, you cannot exhort an unencouraged person. There has to be a relationship before you can exhort them with the word. Look what happens when truth hits that layer of fear. There'll either be conformity, just making it look good, complacency, or callousness can actually occur when you provide truth outside of relationship. The other one's quite interesting. If there's fear in there and you bring truth into it, you can either get growth or rebellion. I can remember once, we're going back 42 years now. There was a guy in church, and he went up to the altar, and I really wanted to encourage him. I was genuine, I wanted to encourage him. So I said, oh, that's great. And I went out to shake his hand. And the next thing I knew, I was looking up at the ceiling. He decked me. And therefore, I'm using that thing to show you that how sometimes truth can form rebellion. Very interesting. Anyway, moving right along. I'll never forget that. So, exhortation occurs when either God or a human speaks into a situation. So, exhortation can occur with a word of knowledge, a word of wisdom, quickening of the memories, bodily memories, good advice, etc. Now, the ministry of encouragement is non-directive, but the ministry of exhortation may occasionally be directive, but never controlling. There are four things: domination, intimidation, manipulation, and control. Those four things represent witchcraft. So if anyone tries to dominate, intimidate, manipulate, or control you, they are actually working in the spirit of witchcraft. One thing I just love about this church is the freedom that we are given without that stuff. We're given the freedom just to be who we are and to develop and bloom where we're planted, even at my age, because that's the way God wants it. I believe heaven is such a precious free will environment that Lucifer could take advantage of that and use it for his own evil desires and rebel against Almighty God. How's that? He was free enough even to do that. All right, stage three. First stage, encouragement. Second stage, exhortation. The three E's, so it's not too hard to remember. The third stage, enlightenment. By this time, they were nearing Emmaus at the end of their journey. Jesus would have gone on, and that's right and proper. God doesn't intrude. He wouldn't have just gone into their house with them. So, no, he went on, which was right and proper for him to do, but they begged him to stay with them the night, since it was getting late. So he went home with them. And they sat down to eat. He took a small loaf of bread, asked God's blessing on it, broke it, and then gave it to them. Suddenly, their eyes were opened, and they recognized him. At that moment, he disappeared. Now, that's called enlightenment. That's the aha moment. Wow, that's Jesus. That has to come by revelation of God. So they've gone in what? An hour? Hour and a half? From being totally gutted to having all their belief systems, their core belief systems changed, and the truth of God's reality come to them. And that's the pattern that I choose and follow in counseling. Encouragement, exhortation, and enlightenment. By the way, they finished their dinner before they ran back to Jerusalem, and I think that was a good thing too. No, it's a male thing, I think. All right. Jesus has just demonstrated the ministry of enlightenment. Enlightenment is the ministry of coming alongside a client to assist them in bringing their thinking in line with God's thinking. Renewing of the mind. Yes. All right. So, let's have a look at this. We have encouragement here from Luke, exhortation there, and enlightenment there. Encouragement targets the hurt. Jesus wouldn't have asked the disciples what they were talking about if it wasn't the presenting issue. If we go back, see there it says the activating event. That's also the presenting issue. The activating event's the presenting issue. Is what surfaces and what needs to be targeted. So Jesus targeted the very real activating event, presenting issue. It was quite easy in that stage. You know, there wasn't anything else that was on their agenda. Okay. However, if you have someone come in to you and spend 1.5 hours downloading without hardly taking a breath, and I have to say, look, can we just stop halfway through? And I go and have a glass of water, come back, and then it's on again for another 3/4 hour. It's hard to know in all of that what's the presenting issue, because 200 things have been just talked about. Well, not necessarily 200, but almost. Did you know that in that stage, God still knows what the presenting issue is? And that's why you can still say, Lord, would you please show this client what it is they need to give to you, what it is they need to know. And he does. He may not always heal a broken arm or a broken leg, but he always heals wrong core belief systems. You have that very, it's as if he is so allergic to lies, because he is truth. He is truth. Truth is a person. It's not something you say necessarily. Truth is a person, and what that person says is truth. What that God says is truth. And so he will actually get out his checklist for that person. Say, right, number one, that's the first thing we want to deal with. And amongst all of that 1.5 hours of downloading, he knows number one. And all you got to do is ask him. That's easy enough, isn't it? And I prefer that the client receives it rather than me. because then it comes first hand, not second hand. Does that make sense? If when they get things first hand, that's when it's going to do the real work. All right. So, first of all, target the hurt, brings encouragement. Next, we need to check out the core belief systems. Now, I have here a great list of core belief systems. Here they are. Now, what do you think was some of the core belief systems of these people, of these two disciples? Do you think they felt abandoned? No one will ever believe me. I've been overlooked. I'll always be alone. I don't matter. Do you think there could be some shame there? I should have done something to have stopped it from happening. I should have known better. So there could be some shame. Was there fear? Yeah, there was definitely fear, particularly from the religious leaders and the Roman soldiers, etc. Fear. powerlessness? Oh, monumental powerlessness. They, as in that gutted feeling, you do not feel you've got any control. And let's go to the next one. Tainted? Perhaps not. Invalidation? Perhaps not. Hopelessness? Yes. Confusion? Yes. Particularly from the report that the women and the disciples who went to the empty tomb would have come. And it's good to have a chart like that, because the clients can actually say, hey, yeah, that one, and that one, and that one, and they can identify their core belief systems. What would have Jesus have done if the activating event wasn't his crucifixion? Now, let's go back again to encouragement, exhortation, and enlightenment. Let's just say that the presenting issue, the activating event, wasn't his crucifixion. Let's say it was some form of, say, childhood abuse. Do you think he'd have used the same scriptures? Do you think he may have actually even talked to that person without necessarily using scriptures, but used ideas and concepts that are so consistent with scripture that coming from his mouth, because he's gone, it is the word of God? And that's what I find over and over again. So, what could be some of the myriads of beliefs that come from physical, emotional, psychological, spiritual, or sexual abuse? And sexual abuse usually has the elements of all these types of abuse, all the above types of abuse. How about this? I just pick some out of the hat. I must not be worth very much if people feel free to abuse me that way. So the sense of self-worth. I now feel such a waste of space in a bent unit. Who would want to be my friend? I'm a solitary person. I'm going to stick with animals as they accept me unconditionally. I often see that, by the way. I can't trust people. Life stinks. If you're a God of love, why have you let this happen to me? And on it goes. These are now their core belief systems. And God would use other ways of attacking those and ministering to them. So, we now have target the hurt, core belief systems, and then God's truth must come in. And when God's truth comes in, that clinches the deal. I wanted this stage of enlightenment when God's truth comes in. I've got a stack here of truths that clients have received over the last 20 years. I've got about a dozen there, 10 or so there. And here are some of the truths that God gives people at the end of a session. Feelings of me being happy, loved, and nurtured. Did you know that's a truth? Feeling of being hated, rejected, and not wanted. lie. And that might be the first time in their whole life. I think for this person, it was the first time in their whole life that they had ever experienced those emotions. One lady saw herself dancing in a beautiful white dress in the presence of the Lord. That's a truth. You may not find it necessarily in Scripture, but it was a truth from God to her. Do you know that that can change her life? A Lion King. You know the Lion King holding up the kid, the baby? Concrete slab being destroyed. We're going to talk a lot about concrete slabs in the next session. Feeling of intense love. Some people actually, for the first time in their life, feel God's love. That's going to change them. How about this? A surgeon examining a patient saying, there's nothing wrong. When that person received that vision, they've been unstoppable ever since. Because it was as if the surgeon was saying, well, you know, I've cut you open and there's nothing wrong. And that's what it took to convince that person that everything was okay. And he wasn't a bent unit. He wasn't a warped individual. Isn't that a brilliant one? That's great. Next, Jesus wrapping his arms around me. That is always wonderful. A picture of me and Dad when I was young. Dad is smiling in the picture. And for that guy to have a smiling dad was amazing, because all he can remember is the angry face. And now he's been given a picture of a smiling dad. So the Lord in many ways returned his dad. A man playing with a dog. This was incredible. playing with a dog. This guy loved his dog. You know, man and his dog kind of thing. And he couldn't see how God loved him. I said, Lord, show him how you see him. And he saw himself playing with his dog. It was a revelation, a word from the Lord. And the message, and he said, what's that about? And am I going crazy? Am I going insane? Well, I can see me playing with a dog. No, mate. The love that you have for that dog is nothing compared to the love that God has for you. In other words, God used something that he knew about. He went from the known to the unknown, from that which was believable to that which he had to work on to actually believe. Brilliant. And these are all enlightenments. Pyramids to cubes. Oh, yeah. This guy released someone and saw a pyramid, you know, with the eye of Osiris or whatever it is, there, which is pretty not the best. And it was interesting. I said, oh, well, I don't believe God uses pyramid power. I believe he uses cubes and rectangular prisms, because the tabernacle is a cube and rectangular prism. He said, what do you say? I said, the tabernacle is cubes. And he said, that's the word I heard in my mind, and I didn't know what it was. So he'd actually heard the word tabernacle from God, and that pushed him along. And of course, people who receive peace for the first time, that is a divine revelation from God, perhaps for the first time in their life. What the Lord gives a client is what I believe to be the ultimate cognitive behavioral therapy. Homework needs to be done. 7 times a day for 3 weeks, that truth from God needs to be revisited in order to renew the mind. I went crook on someone yesterday, if you can believe me going crook on someone, and they hadn't done their homework. To get something precious from God and just let it drop in the mud, I am really, that's not good for me, and it's not good for them. In the other order, hopefully. So, that person has now promised to diligently work on the belief systems that the Lord gave her 7 times a day for the next 3 weeks, which is approximately the time it takes for new neurons to grow in the cerebral cortex of your brain. And that can actually change your thinking. And a change of thinking with new neurons, neuroplasticity, a change of thinking with new neurons can change your feelings, which can change your behavior. Because thinking, feeling, and behavior are kind of all joined together. And now we will take a break. Thank you.